So hi everyone.
So again, this lecture will again be discussing about how to find impedances intuitively. So as I said, in this course, mainly our goal is to understand circuit design and be able to analyze circuits. So first step in circuit design is of course, we have to understand the amplifier architectures. And we also have to understand what is the reasoning for those three, what is the reasoning for an engineer to use one of those three amplifier configurations, either as a voltage or current amplifier as the application necessitates. Now, what we are trying to understand here is that how to analyze circuits intuitively without resorting to rigorous KCLs and KVLs. So that's what we were trying to develop in the last lecture. We will now try to develop in more depth in this lecture as well. So one of the important things whenever you want to analyze a circuit intuitively, the first thing you should know is how to find impedances looking in any node. I said generally impedances, I've used the word looking into a certain node, impedance looking into a certain node. Okay, impedance is normally defined between two terminals. So you can have some circuit and I'm going to look between these two terminals, and then I can define an equivalent impedance between these two terminals. And that can be found by applying a voltage source and measuring the current that's being drawn from this by the circuit. Then take the ratio of voltage to current, you get the input resistance. Now, what I was trying to say is that you don't have to perform KCLs and KVLs every time to find what is this input resistance or resistance seen between two terminals. Most of the cases, we will always refer resistance only with respect to one node. The other node is always assumed to be ground. So in this example, I'm showing in the first example, resistance seen into the base terminal. Okay, so when I'm referring to base, it's always with respect to ground, what is the resistance? Now in the first case, if emitter is grounded, in that case, the entire input voltage which you are applying will appear across VB. So the input resistance is going to be VB upon IB. IB is the base current, that will be the current drawn by this amplifier. So if I'm looking into the base with emitter shorted, collector shorted, what will be the input resistance? I'm looking into the base. Is that fine? It will be R pi. R pi is the resistance that I will see if I look into the base. Now we discussed this result in the previous lecture. If I connect a resistance RE at the emitter. Now here emitter is short circuited. Now here I've connected a resistance of value small, a capital RE. Now what will be the input resistance? We discussed this, we derived this result once in the previous lecture, and I told you just now you have to remember this result. It is R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE. Okay, R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE. This is a result we asked you to remember in the last class. Now in the presence of R naught, this is, if you ignore R naught, you get the first result. In the presence of R naught, I told you that you can model R naught also in parallel with RE. You can model it in parallel with RE. So now the input resistance will become R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE parallel R naught. Right, it will just come in parallel. Now, I'll ask a simple question. What is the minimum input resistance in a common emitter configuration, or rather minimum input resistance when I see into the base? That will happen when emitter is at ground. If I ground this minimum input resistance, what is the value of R in here? It is R pi. So R pi happens to be the minimum input resistance that is possible in a common emitter configuration. Now, the maximum input resistance that is possible is when this is true for both common emitter and common collector configurations. Now I'm going to introduce open circuit RE, meaning here I made RE as zero. Now I'm going to choose RE as infinity. If I choose RE as infinity, and if I ask you what is RN, what will be the value? No, first think first. I first asked you to ignore R naught. Yeah, I think one of you got it right. First, let's say I ignore R naught. If I ignore R naught, then it is infinity. If I ignore R naught, right, then it is infinity. But if I consider R naught, what will happen? Your r naught is always there. There is an r naught present here. That r naught, I can model it from emitter to ground as well. So I will replace this with r naught. So in this case, it's going to be r pi plus beta plus 1 into r naught. The input resistance is going to be r pi plus beta plus 1 into r naught. So this is the fundamental limit. You cannot get a resistance more than this in a common collector configuration. So this is, input resistance. This is the common collector configuration. So when you're looking into the base with collector shorted, this is the ultimate fundamental limit. You cannot get a resistance more than this. Similarly, you cannot get a resistance lower than this. If Rn in a car, if you're looking into the base, the minimum resistance you will get is R pi. Okay, so in this case, I'll call R in base. You're looking, the input resistance looking into the base will generally lie between these two values. So here, collector is at ground. R pi plus beta plus 1 into R naught. Now I'm further going to make an approximation and then say this as, what is this result? So if I look at this, this will be R pi plus, I'll assume beta is much greater than 1. So that will be not CB, CE, common emitter. You mean, I think you meant common emitter. Yeah, that's common emitter configuration. Yeah. Yes, yes, obviously, right? See, in the last class, if you remember, I said R in the input resistance is a strong function of the load. Whatever you connect at the emitter terminal. The minimum value of RE is 0, maximum value of RE is infinity. So it has to vary based on that. Okay, if you ignore R naught, look at the first equation. This is the input resistance for the first equation. R pi is fixed. Once you fix your bias current, R pi is fixed. RE, on the other hand, is something designer connects to a circuit. Now RE is variable. RE can vary from 0 to infinity. So if I ask you to plot the input resistance as a function of RE, it would linearly increase like this. If RE is 0, you get R pi. If RE is infinity, it will also become infinity. That is in the absence of R naught. But if you consider R naught, what all I'm trying to say is, this is the expression you will get. It will become a nonlinear expression. It will be RE R naught by RE plus R naught. So now look, RE, it's a nonlinear function of RE. The graph will look something like this. Ideally, you are expecting it to reach like this, but it will eventually flatten out and reach R naught. We haven't taken R naught to be infinity to get the max resistance because it is not infinity in practical applications. Yes, that's true, obviously. So R naught is not infinity, right? So most practical circuits have a intrinsic gain. Intrinsic gain is measured assuming R naught is finite. R naught cannot be infinity. Okay, it'll always be finite. Now let me come back to this result. So what we are trying to tell you is that even if you make RE as infinity, the fundamental resistance, if you look at this graph, right, what I've shown you here, it will go from R pi to this final limiting value will be R pi plus beta plus 1 into R naught. That's the fundamental value. That's what it will go from R pi to this value. So there is a minimum and maximum values it will take. Now, I'll make some approximations. I'll assume beta is much greater than 1. RE is same as... No, capital RE is a different thing. Small RE is actually R pi by beta plus 1. That's a small signal parameter, small RE. Capital RE is an external resistor that the designer connects. It's an external resistor. Okay? And RL is...
Is it the same as RL?
No, RL is connected at the load resistor. Okay, see... Let me use this word this way. RL is something you connect at the load. See, for example, in a common emitter configuration, RL will be connected at the collector. In a common collector configuration, RL will be connected at the emitter. Okay, so RL is generally the word used for load resistance. That's a resistance you connect at the output. RE is just a gen, see guys, it doesn't matter, it's just a notation. Okay, so RE, if I connect something at the emitter terminal, I'm just calling it as a resistance RE. I mean, it doesn't matter, it's just a notation. It can be RL also, but generally RL is reserved for a value of resistance you connect at the output. Okay, yeah, RE is, see, it can be a common, see, for example, if I ask you to find input resistance of a common collector, common emitter configuration, I can have a structure like this, RL, RE, and VN here. So I might ask you to find RN here. So this is for a common emitter configuration. Okay? Just, I don't want to use the word load, I'm just connecting something at the emitter terminal. It's just a resistor, right? It doesn't matter what terminology I use for it. I'm just connecting some resistance to the emitter terminal. Yes, it's just a resistance I'm connecting at the emitter terminal. It can be load also. It can be load, yeah. Okay, so let me just come back to this expression. So you get R pi plus beta plus 1 R naught. I'm assuming beta is much greater than 1. So that will be R pi plus beta R naught. Generally, let's look at this term beta. What is beta? Beta is GM R pi. Okay. Yes, in case of common collector, RE is RL. Yes. Yeah. So if beta equals GM into R pi, right? I substitute it here. I'll get GM R naught into R pi. Okay. So we make an interesting observation here. We get the lowest possible value, the input base resistance is R pi. The highest possible value is GM R naught times R pi. GM R naught, I told you guys, that's a term we reserve it for the intrinsic gain in a common emitter configuration. Okay, so I'll call it A naught into R pi. So this is the maximum resistance you can get out of a single stage. See, again, I'm assuming GM R naught is much greater than 1. So ideally, it should be A naught plus 1 into R pi. So if you write it this way, you'll get R pi plus GM R pi into R naught. So this can be written as R pi into 1 plus GM R naught. Or approximately, I'm assuming GM R naught is much less than 1. So therefore, greater than 1. So it will be approximately A naught into R pi. Okay. There are two terminologies. A naught into R pi can also be written as beta into R naught. Again, expand A naught as GM into R naught into R pi. So GM R pi is beta, so beta into R naught. So this is like a fundamental limit. This term A naught R pi or beta R naught, we will again encounter a very similar result in another resistance we will be finding out at the later stage. So this is like a fundamental upper limit in a BJT. So can you quickly tell me, if I take a MOSFET, MOSFET is also similar to a BJT, but if I'll assume beta is infinity. So in a MOSFET, what do you think will be the maximum resistance? Even if you assume finite R naught, what do you think, what would you normally expect? Beta is infinity, keep this in mind. So what is the maximum input resistance possible in MOSFET? Infinity, that's it, right? Beta is infinity, so you should expect infinity. So we'll derive for MOSFET separately, but I'm already giving you an idea that you should expect infinity. The only reason why we are not seeing infinity in a BJT, it's because of finite input resistance. R pi is present. In a MOSFET, R pi is infinity. Okay. So we are done with this result. So now you know how to, given a circuit, how to find the input resistance. So all we discussed right now, let me just quickly reiterate this point, because see, initially we are going a little slow so that you absorb the ideas. At a later stage, we'll be very fast in analyzing. We'll be using these results again and again. So you should be able to quickly derive results. The input resistance is R pi in this case. This is the lowest possible value an emitter is grounded. The other condition is, if I'm going to connect a finite emitter resistance, and if I include R naught into consideration, beta can be in zero. See, if beta is zero, then BJT is no longer an amplifying device. It can be infinity if there is no recombination taking place in the base region. Okay, so in that case, beta becomes infinity. If you studied devices, you will know that for a BJT, PNP transistor, NPN, or a bipolar transistor, beta is mainly determined by recombination in the base region, right? So beta can be infinity if there is no recombination in base region, but that's never possible. You will always have recombination in the base region. Okay? Yeah. So is that okay? You got what I said? So if you take a NPN transistor, NPN, yes, for MOSFETs, RPi is infinity because there is no gate current, right? Gate to source, it is oxide. So there is no conduction between gate and source, yeah. See, electrons from N side will diffuse to the P side. Then you apply a forward bias voltage in this PN junction. Some electrons will get recombined in the base region. Okay, those electrons will actually go to the, will come from the supply. Supply will supply for the electrons here. And most of the electrons. So if let's say I'm receiving NE number of electrons into the base region, out of that, alpha times NE will move to the collector region. Most of the electrons will move to the collector region. Okay. Beta, so you take alpha NE divided by the number of electrons which are going here, that will be your beta. So that's how you find it out. Okay. Small fraction gets recombined. That recombined electrons is what we refer to as, that if there is no recombined electrons, then beta will be infinity. See, what is beta? How do you define beta? Beta is the number of electrons you collect at the collector divided by the number of electrons you collect at the base. So that ratio of the two, electron number of electrons or rather current, that becomes, you know, because it's always arriving at a certain rate. So we'll say at a given time, if I'm going to collect alpha NE electrons, here I'm going to collect X electrons, the ratio of the two will be beta. If in base region, no recombination takes place, which means every electron that is entering the base region quickly goes into the collector region without recombining, then alpha will be equal to 1. And this number of electrons going into the base will be 0. So number of electrons going into the collector divided by the base will be infinity. NE upon 0, that will be infinity. That's your beta. That's how you define beta. Okay. Is that okay? Beta will be, it can be infinity, but generally it's never infinity. It will be always less than 100, 200. These are the numbers you can expect. So for a very good BJT, discrete BJTs, which I told you, discrete BJTs are those BJTs which are available, that can be devices which can be mounted on a printed circuit board or on a breadboard. Those BJTs will have around 200 as your beta. Okay. And integrated circuit BJTs, these are the BJTs which will be manufactured in a general MOS process. That will have much poorer betas. It will have 20 to 50. Okay, yeah. So, but if I want to enhance beta, what can I do? If I want to enhance beta for BJT, what should I do? I discussed this idea in one of the previous. What configuration should we go for? If I want to enhance BJT, not cascade. Yes, Darlington. We call use the word Darlington configuration. So we just put two BJTs and then short this way. Now this will behave like a composite BJT. Okay, so that's what we said. Okay, so I'll come back to this result, guys. We'll have to focus on these three. See, I'll derive three results in today's class because you are asking me whether should I consider RS as zero or RL as infinity. How am I going to derive these input resistances? Because in the previous derivations I made some assumptions. I said let's assume R0 is infinity and derive a result. Let's assume RS is infinity and derive a result. I derived that. Now, I'm not going to make those assumptions. I'm going to derive the input resistance keeping RL, RS alive, and then I'm going to derive the input resistance. Now, what I'm telling you is that we just derived it for a common collector configuration, the input resistance with very accurately in the presence of a load resistance, which I'm calling it as RE here, and R0. The input resistance is going to be R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE parallel R0. That's it. So this is the input resistance including R0 and an emitter resistance as well. So now you know how to find the input. This result you have to remember. And I told you, just remember one result. R0 will just come in parallel. So it doesn't matter. So it's a small modification here. So I just asked you to remember one result. Whatever resistance you connect at the emitter region, at the base, if you're looking at the base, it's going to be R pi plus beta plus 1. So it is beta plus 1 multiplied times capital R e. Now I can further simplify this expression and write r pi can be, can I write r pi as small r e is r pi by beta plus 1. So I can write r pi as small r e into beta plus 1. Can I do this? This is something, you know, what is small r e? Small r e is alpha upon gm. That is small signal VBE upon IE. So I can modify this result as RE plus capital RE into beta plus 1. This is a very interesting result. We will see what happens when I derive an emitter resistance. So collector is at ground here. Sorry. Yeah. Is this okay with all of you? It is actually the sum of the emitter resistance. See, this is RE, the resistance connected here. And if you look into the emitter, the resistance into the emitter will be small re. You take the total emitter resistance and multiply it by beta plus 1, you get the base resistance, input resistance seen at the base terminal. That's what this equation is telling us. Is this fine?
Sir, how did we get small re plus capital re into beta plus 1?
No. R pi. See, the expression is r pi plus the, right now I've ignored r naught, or you can include r naught also, it will be r e parallel r naught. Okay, what I'm saying is r pi is nothing but r e into beta plus 1. That's a known result. So I'll apply it here. So then I'll write it as r e into beta plus 1 plus beta plus 1 into r e capital r naught, capital R e parallel R naught. So this is, if I take beta plus 1 common out, I'll be left with R e plus capital R e parallel R naught. If I take it common out, it's just a direct derivation. Is that fine? Or is that what you're asking? It's a derivation, that's it. Yeah. Okay, fine. So keep this result. Now we'll derive another expression, which is the output resistance of a common collector configuration or the emitter resistance. Look at this. I have grounded collector. Collector is at ground. And now I'm looking into the base emitter terminal with a finite source resistance connected at the base, and I'm going to ground it. Okay. I can call this source resistance, or I can call it as a generalized term will be RB. I can call some base resistance. Because I called RE as emitter resistance, I can call this as some base resistance RB. Now, we'll try to find out what is the resistance seen at the emitter. Okay? First case, I'll analyze this ignoring R0. I'll take R0 is infinity, then we'll include R0. So I'm looking here into the emitter terminal. So let's draw the small signal model. So into the base, you have R pi, and this is R pi. You are looking at this terminal. This is the emitter terminal. And you have a current of GM V pi. V pi being the voltage across R pi. R naught is zero. Collector is at ground. What is the resistance you are supposed to find? I'm applying a test voltage Vx. And then measuring the current Ix flowing through this. Okay. That's what I'm going to find. Now, Can you see that R pi and R b are in parallel? Both R pi and R b are in parallel. So I'll just club these together and write it as a single resistance of value. I'll remove V pi now. A single resistance of value, R pi plus R b. What is the current flowing through R pi plus R b in terms of I b, I c? What will be the current flowing? Series, right? They both are in series. R b and R pi. Look at when can we say two resistors are in series? Same current should flow through them. They should share one node in common, one common node, and same current. Not just one common node. Same current should flow through them. Only then I can call two resistors are in series. The current should be same to both of them. So they should have one common node, and the current also should be same. See, the other node of R pi is at emitter voltage Vx. RB, other one is at ground. So therefore, RB and RPI are in series. So I can club this and the model does a single resistance. So now tell me, what is the current flowing through the R pi plus RB? IB, right? Can I say that's just the base current? Is that fine? The current flowing through R pi plus RB is just the base current. And what is this current in terms of base current? GMB pi, what can I write it as? In terms of IB, what will be GMB pi? Beta times IB. So this is beta times IB. So this is IB and beta times IB. So can you express IX in terms of beta times IB? What will be IX in terms of beta times IB? Yes, IX will be beta plus 1 with a minus sign, of course, because the current directions are in this way. Okay, so we'll write it as this as minus. Now all I need to find is Vx upon Ix. So Ix, we just found out it is minus of beta plus 1 into Ib. So can you tell me what is Vx in terms of Ix and see, what is this voltage drop? The voltage drop here plus minus, this will be Ib into Rx plus R pi plus Rb. Can I say that? Ib, so you have a resistance like this. So let me just redraw that circuit. So this is, I'm exaggerating it, R pi plus Rb. You have a current, so this is Ib flowing through that. And this node is connected to Vx. So this node is Vx with respect to ground. This is Vx with respect to ground. It's not minus B pi, I'll come to that. Because of V pi is the voltage across R pi. Now we have a series of two resistors. So now the voltage across this, yes, that is right. Ib into R pi plus R pi. So this voltage across this will be Ib into R pi plus RB. So will it be plus minus? What will it be? So if I ask you Vx, will it be Ib into R pi plus RB is fine. Will it be plus or minus? Minus. Yes, right? Because this voltage is Vx positive. So but here it is negative here. So it will be minus. So therefore, if I ask you to find the ratio of Vx by Ix, that's going to be minus of Ib into R pi plus RB divided by Ib into beta plus 1 with a minus sign. So what do you get? You get another interesting result, R pi plus RB by beta plus 1. Okay, this is a very interesting result. This is the total base resistance divided by beta plus 1. See this? Previously, if you see the total emitter resistance, Re plus small re into beta plus 1 was the resistance seen at the base. Now we are looking into the emitter, it is getting divided. So I can write this in a more simplistic way this way. R pi by beta plus 1 plus Rb by beta plus 1. Now what is this R pi plus beta plus 1 in terms of small re? What is that? Small re, right? Small re plus Rb by beta plus 1. So we get a very interesting result. What does this tell us is that if you take a NPN or a common collector configuration, if you have a source resistance, if I have a source resistance and I ask you, ignore R0 for the time being, and I ask you what is the input resistance seen by the load, or rather what is the output resistance? What will that be? Small re plus Rb by beta plus, Rs by beta plus 1. So whatever resistance is present here, you have to divide it by beta plus 1. Is that okay? That will be your resistance seen into the base terminal. Fine, right? Is this result fine? Whatever value is present at the base, divided by this. Now let me give you an example. Let me give you a complex circuit this way. In this circuit, ignore R0. R0 is infinity. Assume that R0 is infinity. Divide by beta plus 1. Beta plus 1. You Re, small re, plus whatever resistance is present at the base terminal. When you are looking at the emitter, divide that by beta plus 1. Yeah. Now, you are given a circuit like this. Guys, you have three transistors, identical transistors,
we will tell you that they are all biased to the current, collector quiescent current, they are all biased to the quiescent current. Now you are supposed to find the input resistance seen at this point. The resistance seen at this point. How will you find it? We did something in common collector. Yes, you go step by step. Go step by step. What is the resistance seen here? If you are looking into the emitter base is grounded, what is the resistance seen at this point? You are looking into the emitter base is grounded. It will be small RE, right? We discussed this already in the last class. It will be R pi by beta plus 1 or small RE. So replace this BJT with small RE. So this will be now small RE. Now what is the resistance seen at this point? It will be small RE plus small RE by beta plus 1. Small RE which comes as it is here, that plus small RE by beta plus 1. Is that okay? Now replace this whole BJT with a resistance of value given by small RE plus small RE by beta plus 1. Now if I ask you what is the resistance seen at this point, what will be the resistance? So it will be this whole thing, small RE plus RE by beta plus 1, the whole thing by 1 by beta plus 1 plus small RE. That's it. So that's how you analyze this problem. You got it, right? So if you give you a more complex circuit like this, you can analyze any circuit and we ask you to find a node resistance, you have to remember this result. The result to remember here, first I'm ignoring R0. If I ignore R0, then I'll include R0 as well. First step, we analyze it assuming simpler results, then we'll include it. The resistance seen here is small RE plus whatever resistance is connected at the base terminal to ground divided by beta plus 1. That's it. Remember this result. Small RE is actually alpha by GM. Plus RS upon beta plus 1. Okay, that's the input resistance, output resistance of a common collector configuration. You're looking into the emitter with collector grounded. Now, can you guys simply tell what will happen if I have R0? What shape will I have? Will there be this equation if I include R0? Just include R0 here. I'm looking at this point. Can I simply say R0 is going to be coming in parallel with the whole thing? Yes, R0 will come in parallel. No, not in series. It can't be in series. No, R0 will be totally. See, I can first find the resistance seen here, which will be RE plus RS by beta plus 1. That, then if I connect these two, R0 is in parallel. So I'll write this whole thing in parallel with R0. That's what you get here. See, the whole output resistance that you find here at this node, that can be modeled as a single resistance of value. See, this is the emitter terminal. This is the emitter. I can model it as a single output resistance whose value is given by this. So that in parallel with R0 will be your total output. Not RS parallel R0, but rather RE plus RS by beta plus 1 parallel, the whole thing parallel R0. This whole thing parallel R0. Okay. See, first, if I have a source resistance here, if I ask you what is the equivalent resistance, let's ignore R0 for the time being. That result is pretty simple. RE plus RS by beta plus 1. That's the total resistance. Now, if I'm going to connect another resistance like this, say Rx, some other resistance here, and if I ask you what is the total resistance at this node, how will you find out? You'll apply a voltage and find the current that's flowing through that. That current will be the current flowing through the device here, plus the current flowing through the resistance. The voltage is same across both. So now I'll replace the whole device with a value given by R out is given by this equation. So now if I ask you, what is the total resistance seen by Vx? It will be R out in parallel with Rx, because both are in parallel, right? One node is common for R, both the resistors, and the other one is AC ground. Both are common. So these both will come in parallel. And that is Re parallel RS, Re plus RS by beta plus 1, the whole thing in parallel with R naught. Okay, that's it. So that's the result we get out of an emitter. If you look into the emitter, and if I connect a resistance RS here, we know how to find the resistance now in an exact expression, in a more exact way. Now tell me, what will be the value when RS is infinity? If RS is infinity, what will be the limiting value here? The R out here, what will be the limiting value? Or looking into the resistor, if RB is infinity, R naught, can you see that? Because what happens is, if RB is infinity, the emitter base current is zero. If base current is zero, emitter current is also zero. So this MOSFET, this BJT doesn't carry any current. Okay, so you can see that in the R, you can plug in this equation. If RS is infinity here, this term will be infinity. Infinity in parallel with R will be R naught itself. So this is R naught, even RS is infinity. If you open circuit the base and look into the emitter with collector grounded, it's going to be R naught. So that's it. I have derived two important results here. Both are applicable for common collector configuration, mainly for common collector. One of the results is also applicable for common emitter configuration. If I'm connecting an emitter resistance to the emitter terminal, physical resistance, if you include R naught, now I'm writing a more general expression, that's going to be R pi plus beta plus 1 into Re parallel R naught. The second expression, again, this is valid perfectly for common collector configuration. Collector is grounded, base resistance RS, or rather, let me write it as RB. It's just a notation, it shouldn't matter. You're looking at the output here. If I'm asked to write the general expression, it's going to be, keep R naught aside first. It'll be RE plus small RE plus RB upon beta plus 1. So whatever resistance is the base gets divided by beta plus 1. This whole thing will come in parallel with R naught. So we have derived two results now. Okay. You just have to remember this part. R naught is just an after effect. It's just very simple to include in both the analysis. So these are the two results we just discussed today. The next one, this is one of the most important results. We will encounter this even in MOSFETs. See, in MOSFETs, what happens is, most of the cases in MOSFETs, your beta is infinity. Since your beta is infinity, Rn will always be infinity. For low frequencies, Rn will always be infinity. You don't really care. If you look into the gate, you'll always get infinity. And this result will always be, small Re in a MOSFET is 1 by gm parallel R naught. It'll always be that. So it's much more simplified in MOSFET, so which is why if you can derive for a BJT, in MOSFET analysis will be very simple. We'll come to that again. At that point, we'll again discuss all these results again. So now, the most important result is the resistance seen at the collector terminal. Now I'm going to look at the collector terminal, and I'm interested in finding resistance seen into the collector terminal. Now, when I'm deriving this result, I'm going to derive it for two different cases, and I will also generalize it again. The first case, I'm going to assume base is at ground. So this result will generally be applicable for common base configuration, what we are going to derive. And I'm going to assume there is a finite emitter resistance RE present. Now, let me ask you this. First, let's analyze the simplest case when RE is zero. What will be the value of the collector resistance when RE is zero? What will be the R out? R naught, right? That will simply be R naught, because it is VCE by IC. This is the collector current, so it will be VCE by IC, which will be R naught itself. So the output resistance C will be small R naught itself. So now I'm just adding a resistor in series. What will be your first thought process? What do you think will be your output resistance? I'm just putting a resistor in series. What do you think will be? Okay. See, that's the first thought process, but it will not be that. Okay. It will be, you will first think it will, maybe there is an R naught here. So R naught plus RE. That's what your mind would first say. Because first time when you look at the circuit, that's what you will think. But that's not right. Because there is also a BJT here. BJT has a finite VBE. BJT has a finite VBE. So you will have to include the effect of the BJT as well. So you will see the result will be slightly bit more complicated. It will not be R naught plus RE. In fact, it is wrong. If you write R naught plus RE, it is wrong. Okay. When can you write R naught plus RE? If there was only R naught and RE, one common node, and currents are also same to both of them. Right now, of course, R naught and RE share one common node, but are the currents same? They are not same. R naught is carrying some current. The current through RE is current through the BJT plus the current through R naught. Right? It has two paths here. So therefore, the current through RE will not be that. So I'll first derive this result using small signal models. They form a potential divider. You can't still say that. I'll come to that. We'll go one step by step. We'll go step by step. We can't derive that way. So you're learning for the first time, they don't form a potential divider. See, in a potential divider, generally, they both have to be in series. So even for a potential divider, right? If both are in series, then the current flowing in the potential divider circuit is Vx by, I'm applying a voltage Vx here, R1 plus R2. That will be the current. That multiplied by R2 will be the voltage division across R2. So that will be potential division. But here it's not. The currents are different. Okay, we'll come to that. We'll derive it by first performing a rigorous analysis. So let's draw the small signal model. The small signal model looks something like this. You have R pi to ground. Then you have GM V pi. V pi is the voltage across this. And then we have R naught here. And finally, this resistor here is capital RE. Now, what are we doing? We are finding the resistance seen at this node. So we are applying a test voltage Vx and trying to measure this current Ix. Okay. Now, to simplify this analysis, I'm going to make a small assumption. What will be the emitter voltage here? What is Ve here in terms of V pi? See, Ve is with respect to this node to ground. This the voltage is VE. What is V pi? V pi is the what is V pi? Is it equal to V pi? Is there a sign plus minus V pi? How is that? Minus V pi, right? It is a minus V pi. So VE is minus V pi. Just keep this result in mind. Now, can you tell me if R pi and RE are in parallel? Are they in parallel? Are R pi and RE in parallel? Yes, right? They share both the common nodes. So therefore, I'll simplify this circuit and then write it as RE in parallel with. So this result will be RE in parallel with R pi. And this voltage is VE. Now, look at this circuit here. Ix is the current that's flowing through this. Ix is the current that is entering here. Kirchhoff's current law is always valid. And then I'll reduce this result and write this way. Instead of GM V pi, can I write it as minus GMVE? Because V pi is minus VE, it will be minus GMVE. Now I'm going to change the direction of current source. Instead of current flowing downward, I'll write an upward going current of value GMVE. Instead of minus, I'll write plus GMVE flowing from collector to emitter, emitter to collector. Is this okay? I already did this connection many times, so this should be fine, right? Yeah. Now, let's write KCLs and KVL. For the first time, we'll derive this result. Then I'll give you the intuitions. You have a current Ix flowing through this. That current Ix comes here, splits into two parts. Then both the currents join together and combine and eventually flow through the emitter. So if I ask you, what is the current through this terminal? What is the current through VE, resistor, RS, RE parallel RB? What will that be in terms of Ix? Ix, right? It'll exactly be equal to Ix. So it will be Ix. So the emitter voltage VE equals
Ix into capital R e parallel R pi. So we have one equation here. Now we'll apply Kirchhoff's current law at this node. Which is at this node. If I write the current Ix, so let me redraw that. So I'm just redrawing the circuit here. This is GMV. This is R naught. And here it is RE parallel R pi. And you're looking into the collector terminal. You have applied a voltage Vx and a current Ix is flowing through this. See, this node voltage is Vx. This node voltage is VE. So if I write Kirchhoff's current law at this point, you will write it as Ix equals the current flowing through R naught. So the current leaving this node, is R naught, current from through R naught, which will be Vx minus VE by R naught. That's the current flowing through R naught plus, or now rather I'll write minus GMVE. Okay, minus GMVE. So we'll write Ix equals Vx by R naught minus of 1 by R naught plus GM into VE. I have just taken all the terms to VE aside. So now what will I do? I'll bring this term to this side. So you'll have VE into 1 by R naught plus GM plus Ix, which is Vx by R naught. Now what is VE in terms of Ix? VE, we said this is Ix. So the emitter voltage is Ix into RE parallel R pi. Capital RE parallel R pi. So substitute this here, take this result and substitute it here. What you will get is RE parallel R pi into Ix into 1 plus GM R naught divided by R naught. So I have taken R naught common. This plus Ix. So the whole thing will be equal to Vx by R naught. So again, I'll take R naught this side and Ix common out. So you'll be left with R naught plus 1 plus GM R naught into RE parallel R pi equals Vx. R naught and R naught will cancel out. So the result Vx by Ix is R naught plus 1 plus GM R naught into RE parallel R pi. So this is a little bit of a complicated expression. First time when you look at it, it might look complicated, but this is the most commonly used result. We will use this result so many times, we will see throughout this course. So the way in which you remember this result, keep this in mind. I'll discuss this result intuitively later. At a later stage, we'll discuss this result intuitively. Right now, if you have some resistance RE at the emitter terminal, and you're looking at the collector, so you're supposed to find the output resistance. Write it as 2. First, you have R naught plus RE parallel R pi. Okay, because R pi is also in parallel. So you have a resistance R pi here. That will also come in parallel with RE. Plus the resistance RE parallel R pi into GM R naught. So RE parallel R pi into GM R naught. So this is the final expression for output resistance seen at the collector, a more generalized expression seen at the collector if RE is finite for a BJT. The expression looks a little bit complicated, but you will see that once you analyze, keep analyzing more circuits, this result will look quite intuitive. For the first time, it might look a bit complicated. Is that okay? So you may have to, you have to remember this result as well. It's an open book. Again, we don't expect you to derive this every time. If we give you a circuit like this, know how to apply this result formula. That's it. So you just have to know this result as well and use this result and you can apply it. Okay, output resistance increases. So oftentimes what we do is we ignore the first term, we ignore the second term and simply approximate this to the third term, which will be RE parallel R pi into GM R naught, because that term will be larger than the first two terms.
right? It is gm r naught times larger. So it's a really large number. So generally this third term will be larger. So in that case, generally make this approximation. R e parallel r pi, capital R e parallel r pi into gm r naught. Okay? If gm r naught is much greater than 1. This is a more exact expression. Most sometimes we may be using this result as well. Fine? So keep this result as well in mind. Now let's derive one limiting condition in this result. Just I'll take just two minutes. Let's assume r e is infinity. If r e is infinity, what do you think will be your output resistance? So this is r naught. Base resistance is here. You have a resistance of value r pi here. You are looking at this point. Is that okay? It is r pi into gm r naught. So if r e is infinity, it is approximately r pi into gm r naught. This I can write it as r pi into gm r naught as a naught times r pi or beta times r naught. So this is the fundamental upper limit of output resistance. In a BJT, if you look into the collector terminal, you cannot get a resistance more than this. Okay, base is grounded here. If base is grounded, you even if you open circuit the emitter, you cannot get a resistance more than beta R naught. Remember, we encountered the same result, the maximum resistance with R naught being present in a common collector configuration. Emitter is open circuit. RE was infinity. We got the same result. We got this also, the input resistance to be approximately beta times R naught or A naught times R pi. Okay, so keep these results in mind. Again, in the next class, I'll conclude this discussion, point out all the important results, and we'll solve the tutorial question. Okay, so I may take a class depending even today or tomorrow, depending on my availability. Okay, one class. So just I'll bring up all the things. I'll put it together in one place, so that you are ready, you know how to use these results. Then finally, on the, we'll also finish our tutorial, because I'm supposed to finish it. I haven't solved tutorial questions yet. So I'll solve tutorial questions on Monday, or on Saturday, or mostly on Saturday, I'll solve it. Okay, thank you. No, this result is valid for common collector configuration. Not common collector, common emitter. Because in common collector, collector is ground. See, this result which we have derived right now, you are looking into the collector. Okay, so it is generally valid for common base and common emitter. In both common base and common emitter, collector is the output. In both common base and common collector is output. So it will be like that.